Awesome. Thank you. All right. Whoa. So I'm really worried about science and especially science literacy, because whenever I turn on the news, I see things like people don't believe in vaccines or they don't believe in climate change. And I think we're in a time where we need science now more than ever because of those issues. And so about a year and a bit ago, I quit my job as a science teacher, but I did that in order to make videos about science full time, because I wanted to reach as wide of an audience as possible. And I have had a really weird year since then. And I want to talk to you about four of the projects that I've worked on in 2018 that relate to what it means to be a human in the cosmos, or our place in space. And I'm going to start with what I was working on, which Michael mentioned. A year ago, I was making these dominoes. And I was making the dominoes because I needed so many dominoes that you just actually cannot buy that many dominoes. I made a tote bag of dominoes because I wanted to make a timeline of the universe's history from the Big Bang to modern day. And in that timeline of dominoes, each domino would represent 1 million years. And the universe is really old. So that was 13,799 dominoes. And it took me 4 days to set them up. On the first day, I was kind of nervous and making some mistakes, and they were falling. On the second day, I was, you know, being like, okay, I got this. By day number three, I was like, let's just get this over with. And by day four, I was kind of losing my mind and took it a little less seriously. The final row of dominoes was 300 meters long. And I got to tell you, it totally changed my perspective on the age of the universe. Because I mean, it's one thing to just know that the universe is 13.8 billion years old, but it's another thing to like physically, gruelingly go through that process. And I'll never forget. But eventually, I knocked over the first domino and began to narrate the universe's history as they were falling, because they fell for 9 minutes, which I think might be a world record, but in terms of duration at least. And I'm trying to narrate it, and I'm really nervous because on the first take, it just stopped abruptly. and then we set them back up, and I was like, oh man, there's no way. Yeah, and I'm like, there's no way we're gonna get through 13,000 of these. I only made it through a few hundred. But on the second take, amazingly, to me at least, it worked, and we made it to these last few dominoes. And up in the top left of this, you can see the dinosaurs going extinct. This is in slow motion. And the last four and a bit dominoes is all of human history, just there. And that's after 300 meters of dominoes. And that blew my mind. And I really wanted to do a project where I zoomed in even further on that, because still, those four dominoes, that's a lot of time. So I did another project. And in this second timeline, 1 year was going to be 1 centimeter. And I wanted to start 4.2 million years ago, and that's 42 kilometers. So I started training for a marathon because, you know, I wanted to go from when we were living in trees to present day. And it was logistically complicated to like film a marathon and narrate it while running, but eventually we made this thing work. And it took an hour of running from when we lived in trees, an hour of running just to get as far as having stone tools. And, you know, and our species, or not our species, but our ancestors are starting to walk upright. And after 2 hours of running, you know what we've got? We've got better stone tools. And that's it. And you know, it takes another full hour of running, and I'm like pretty tired at this point, but I gotta keep going. And we find out how to use and control fire. And after another full hour of running, us, Homo sapiens, evolve. And another 40 minutes of running finally brings me to the last minute. And in that last minute, we have farming and writing and you and me. But I wanna talk about just that last meter of that timeline. Because if I started this run in White Rock, BC, near the border, the American border, I would run 42 kilometers all the way here to the Fox. And this last meter would have so much history in it. It would have the first transatlantic radio signal. It would have the first nuclear bomb, Sputnik, the first space satellite that we made, Apollo missions to the moon. And the whole World Wide Web is this last little foot, and around there is my whole lifetime. And that kind of blows my mind, because as I'm running, I'm thinking about that, and I'm thinking that, you know, this is my life, and this whole timeline from when we first started walking till now, that took me 49,000 steps. And in all of that time, you know, in the last few meters, humans have done a lot to the planet. And that's kind of terrifying, but I also think that, like, you know, I want to talk more about this and, like, show people about this, and how do we know these things? You know, like, the Big Bang. Well, how do we know that that happened? And how do we know our genetic ancestry? And how do we know all of that history? We know it from science, and it's a process that I wanted to demonstrate, and I wanted to show how that process worked. So I decided to, using this, to measure the Earth. And I did that with this and my bike, but first, I'm gonna demonstrate it with an orange. So let's pretend that this orange is the Earth, and we're gonna put two sticks into it. Very scientific. Now, this is not to scale, but if we have two sticks in the orange at different angles, since the orange is round, and since the sun is very far away, the light hits these sticks, and they make different lengths of shadows. These are spotlights, so they don't really count. But if you measure the lengths of the shadows, you can figure out the angle that they would meet up at in the center of the orange. If you measure the distance between the two sticks, you can figure out, using some math, don't be afraid, the distance around the entire orange. And you can also do that with the actual Earth. It doesn't have to be an orange. So I did that by taking two of these meter sticks, this was one of them, and making two little simple sundials, just sticks with numbers. And I put those and my bike on a plane, and I went to Regina, Saskatchewan, because look at that, Saskatchewan's really, really flat. And that means that there's one of the straightest, longest roads in the entire world there. And so I set up a sundial in Regina, and I strapped the other one to my bike, and I biked 138 kilometers in a perfectly straight line, which was something. And I set up the other sundial, and we did this experiment. And, you know, honestly, like, it feels smaller now that I've done this experiment. Like, 138 kilometers is a long way, but the world feels like a smaller place. Is it repetitive? Yeah, but I also spent most of it listening to Daft Punk, specifically Around the World, and there's basically no lyrics. It is the most repetitive song ever, actually. But anyway, did the experiment, measured the shadows, measured the distance between the sticks, and it worked. We managed to measure the size of the Earth, and that was cool. We also confirmed that the Earth is round, which you're laughing because that seems obvious to you, but that's not obvious to a lot of people. Many people in America and Canada believe that the Earth is flat. And when I say many, I mean in a survey that looked at 8,000 people and asked them about the shape of the world, 16% were not sure or were skeptical or were convinced that the world is flat. And I know these aren't trolls. These people are for real. Because a lot of them have contacted me. And I get a lot of messages still sometimes, like this. This is one message. I'm going to summarize as saying, you know, this person believes in a lot of conspiracies. There's some kind of simple-ish logic to their arguments, but NASA is lying to you, and all of their photos are fake. And, you know, first, your instinct is to be like, what? Is this for real? Is this person? This guy's not. This is fake, right? And then second, your second instinct, naturally, is like, you're an idiot, right? You just want to name call them, you want to, you know, throw some evidence at them. But really, I think that is a typical response. It's intuitive, but it's broken, because I think these people really, truly, honestly need compassion. I think if we approach them by yelling at them, we're just going to push them away further to the fringes and further polarize issues like this. And maybe it doesn't matter that much for an issue like flat Earth, but it does matter for a lot of science issues, and we need to, everyone, start thinking about how we interact with one another on these topics. I think everybody needs to be more scientific in terms of how we reason, but also much more human in terms of how we communicate with one another, whether or not you're a science communicator. So I've talked a little bit about the universe and its age, and I've talked a little bit about our tiny little sliver of that timeline, and I've talked a bit about the scale of the Earth. But I wanted to finish off the year with a big project about the air, because the most important issue I think we're facing today is climate change. And it's an issue that, like the shape of the Earth, most people do not understand at all. And so I decided to do a project on that. And if anyone knows me, they'll know, like, yeah, of course, the idea that came to mind first is I'm going to build a jar, and I'm going to seal myself inside of it with plants. And so I built a 10-foot by 10-foot by 10-foot cube, and I filled it with 200 plants and some food and some water and a bucket, and I covered it in greenhouse plastic and sealed myself inside. And, whew, like, sometimes I lose my breath just thinking about how fun this was. The plan was that the plants would produce oxygen for me, and I would exhale carbon dioxide for them, and we would be this tiny little ecosystem that would represent, in a way, the Earth. And I could use that to demonstrate how we interact with the air we breathe. And in order to do this, I needed to research the air like my life depended on it, because it did. And but eventually, you know, once I was comfortable enough with my research and my planning, I went inside, and I sealed myself inside. And while I was in there, I was really worried particularly about one gas, which is carbon dioxide, CO2. It's a gas that you exhale. And we're also worried about that as a species, because it's one of the main gases that's causing the climate to change. And carbon dioxide actually only makes up a tiny, tiny fraction of the air. We measure it in parts per million. And this is a graph with carbon dioxide in ppm, parts per million, on this axis. And then on the bottom is time. And this is the graph from the gas that was in there with me in the jar. And it started off, well, at 400 parts per million. And after every hour, it just kept going steadily, steadily up. And that was because it was a cloudy day. Unfortunately, I had to do it on a specific day. And this one didn't allow the plants to photosynthesize for me very well. So very rapidly, it reached 10,000 parts per million, at which point my sensors couldn't even detect how much carbon dioxide was in there. So I had to escape for safety. I should say, obviously, don't try this at home, because I had a paramedic on site, and we had lots of safety equipment. But eventually, I did have to leave the jar. And a nice breath of fresh air. That was the best breath I've ever had. But while I was in there, a lot of things changed, including the water that was in there with me. It became more acidic, because carbon dioxide, it dissolves in water, and it makes carbonic acid. And that's also the same thing that's happening to our oceans. And I also started to feel the air, like, inside of me. It was like this thick mass. And it started to totally change my perspective on the air, because it's rather remarkable, but we live in this invisible fluid, and it keeps us alive. Like, think about that. That's absolutely incredible. But at the same time, we literally just see right through it every day. And that also means we don't treat it very well, because it's an invisible problem. While I was in there, and before going in there, I thought a lot about what it means to have a carbon footprint and our impact on the environment, because our breath is like the smallest factor. So if I look at my carbon dioxide emissions from my body, and I compare that to factors like driving or meat, well, one day, 24 hours worth of breathing, exhales, puts out the same amount of carbon dioxide as driving just 1 kilometer. And the same amount of emissions account for one bite of steak. So it's a big deal. Like, these are big values. These are big values, because if you think about it, like, if I stayed a full day in there, I actually could have died. And so I've been asking myself this question, which is, would I do that blank if I was in my jar? Because, you know, I wouldn't have ever dared to, I didn't even cook food in there because that would release gases that could, you know, CO2 that could kill me. And I wanted to be very careful about that, but I still want to think like that. It might sound radical, but like, we do need to have some sort of radical solution to these sorts of problems. And I think we need to start thinking in extreme measures. So no, I won't, you know, fill my biodome with plastic and garbage because, I mean, that'd be really messy and gross in there. And I don't think we should be doing that to Earth. Sounds radical, but they're both closed ecosystems. And I think we need to treat them that way. The other thing that I learned about doing this project is that every experiment, it's a story. This was an unusual experiment, but every experiment is you have a question and you want to find an answer and you do some methods and you go on this adventure and you find the result. And people love stories. People are really engaged. I think we're hardwired for stories. And so this story did really well in terms of making, you know, getting outreach about climate change. It trended on Twitter while I was in there and made international news. And I'm not saying that to brag about it. I'm saying that because I almost didn't do this project altogether, because in the lead up to it, I was completely freaking out about it. And I was like waking up in the middle of the night and I was worrying, you know, maybe I'll do all this work and no one will even know and the message will be lost. Or maybe I'll do all this work and I'll go in there and I'll have missed something and it will like be dangerous to me. But as any brilliant YouTuber, I foolishly announced that I was going to do it, so I kind of felt committed. So I announced it on my channel, and I decided, you know, I said I'm going to do this thing, I'm going to do this thing. And that's been like a good lesson for me, even if it was kind of hard at times, because I think we do need to set these crazy, lofty goals and try our best and commit to them. Question I get asked a lot is, so what's next? And since I'm now in the business of making commitments, I want to share with you some of my commitments for 2019, which is, firstly, I'm going to stay committed to science. I want to make, first and foremost, my content to be really scientifically accurate and also engaging. I want people to think about the scientific method. I'm also going to be trying to do more environmental projects, so I want to change my lifestyle and my work to be zero waste by the end of 2019, which means I'm going to have to cut out a lot of plastic and learn to recycle better and work on that. And lastly, I want to reduce my carbon emissions, because I think that's something everybody needs to do. And you know, it's gonna be hard, but I want my emissions from 2019 to be less than 2018, which is honestly a small step, but I hope that, you know, if you're making New Year's resolutions and you're thinking about what you can change in 2019, you'll try to set some big goals for yourself. And you know, anything is possible. It's been a weird year for me, but it's been a good one. My name is Kurtis Baute, and if you want to support the work I do, you can find me on Patreon. Or if you just want to see what I'm up to, you can find me really anywhere on the internet. Just search Kurtis Baute or Guy Seals Himself in a Jar. That's my life. Thank you.